All right. Welcome back. Last module on this Friday afternoon, evening, morning, late night, wherever it is that that you happen to be. Thanks for sticking with us. I apologize. You know, look, it takes an awful lot of work to get each little strand of hair.
And gel,
yes,
too, I noticed.
Yes, right. Yeah, the exact right
and
spot.
And the hairspray in my face.
It takes
like,
a full team to put this together. But in any event, once again, just as a real quick refresher for those of you who may have forgotten, that's Tom over there. Christopher over here at Reezing. At Geek Trainer, this is Developing SharePoint Server Advanced Solutions. Last module, getting back in, taking a look at social networking. Tom, let's see what you got.
Thank you so much, Christopher. We are social. Are you following us? We'll learn about following in SharePoint.
Excellent. Let's take a look.
And we call this customizing the social workload. Let's take a look at our overview for the module.
Mm-hmm.
We will be talking about how you develop social solutions. We'll be talking about how you are working with feeds. You may know these by another name. They could be an activity stream.
Yep.
Or a news feed, right?
Yep.
Is one way it's referred to. And at the end, I will show you how you can create a social app part. We've done client-side development, but so far today, we have not seen a single app part, so I thought I'd mix it up a little
bit. Yeah, let's do an app part.
And do an app part.
I like it.
So let's start just talking about developing social solutions. We've talked a little bit already about how you develop a social solution with starting with people. Right?
Yep.
People are at the heart of any social solution. But now we can go a little bit further into a different set of the subset of the API and look into the purely social functions like following and mentioning and things like that. Right? And here we go. Here's exactly what I want to start talking to you about. Tagging and following entities by using out-of-the-box functionality is going to be our first demo. I just want to get you into the browser, seeing what the social functions look like. Once again, we'll talk about app permissions and what are actors, the types of things you can follow, and the managing how you follow from the code. So can I follow you? We'll find out.
All right.
And what the difference is between following and liking. So once again, I'm going to do this demonstration. Like after the BCS, I'm all SharePoint Online. I'm all Office 365 all the time. So we're going to do some tagging and following in SharePoint Online.
Perfect. Now, as you're kicking over there, one of the things that's worth highlighting real quickly here, what Tom's about to do, is he's going to go in and take a look at things inside of the UI. If you've been doing SharePoint 2007, 2010, you're probably already familiar with things like user profiles and that little bit of a news feed that we had in particular with 2010. All of this has been greatly enhanced now in 2013, so that if you're familiar with things like Facebook and Twitter, you get a lot of that same functionality inside of SharePoint now, which is actually a great boon to our users. Without getting too deep into it, a lot of times you get pushback from management, hey, you know what, we really don't want social networking inside of our environment. People get afraid, you know, that it's going to wind up being a time sink. I always like to remind them, don't worry, there's no Candy Crush for SharePoint, you know, so those different things that people are doing on Facebook isn't going to happen. Well, I suppose you could go ahead and build an app. So maybe there's your million-dollar idea. But in any event, what we want to do is take a look at some of that new functionality, what's available to you out of the box, start defining things. So that way, when we turn around and take a look at the code side, you sort of know what it is that we're talking about.
Yeah, thanks for pointing that out, Christopher. I mean, if you look at social today, it's prevalent throughout the consumer space, right? Everybody at home is using Facebook and Twitter, and they're commenting and liking and sharing all over the place, right? I mean, we could say that Facebook and Twitter did it, but look, my mom's been sending me articles from the Washington Post for 10 years by email, right? This is just a way to move things out of email into the more efficient tool for it. Because honestly, email was invented to replace physical mail, right?
Yeah.
And it really works a lot more like physical mail than this digital age that we're a part of. So SharePoint is getting in the game. SharePoint 2013 has some social features, and as developers, we have access to them in the client-side object model.
Let's go take a look at what we can do.
Let's take a look here. I've got my my standard team site at SharePoint Online. So this is just what you start with. And let's see where it starts to get social. Right at the top here, you see my share and follow, right, are available on any team site.
Yep.
And then where we really start to get into it is when I go to the About Me section, right? In my About Me section, you can see that I'm following a new site that was just added today called Community.
Excellent.
I'm following Pro Branding.
You're looking good over there, by the way, in the upper left.
I posted, right? I've got a picture of me. Now, that is a big part of social, right?
Yeah.
We can say that, you know, social sounds like a lot of fun, but really it's a way that we connect with other people.
Yes.
And the visuals are really very important. In fact, I've heard it said that Facebook, another way to look at Facebook is the biggest photo sharing site on the web.
Yeah. Yep.
And it really is. It has the most pictures shared on it. And one of the reasons is because when we're being social, we are being visual and we are connecting with other people. And facial recognition is a big part of that, right?
Yep.
So when you're, this has nothing to do with development, but a general social tip is when you're posting a picture of yourself on your internal social site, like SharePoint, my sites, you want to use a close cropped headshot that's a good a good rendition of what you actually look like in person, because that's what you're trying to do with social. You're trying to connect with other people.
Mm-hmm.
So great. So if I come here to my site and I click on my news feed, there's a funny thing happening right here on my site right now. I'll just go ahead and point it out because someone might notice. On the top, you may see that I've got the Yammer link.
Yeah, Yammer. Okay.
Right. So that's something that you can change in the administration settings for your SharePoint tenant in SharePoint Online.
Mm-hmm.
You can change it so that the top bar here, instead of saying newsfeed, says Yammer.
Okay.
Right. And then what happens is you click it and it takes you to yammer.com.
Okay.
Right. You can change it back. It takes about 10 minutes. I think you might actually see it change back sometime during my demo. But the funny thing is it doesn't take away this newsfeed link on the left-hand side. So that one's still there.
A lot, but okay, all
right. Right, right. Anyway, in this case it's helpful because I don't want to talk about Yammer. That's not part of the curriculum we're working on or the test. I want to talk about SharePoint Social because that's what the test covers and that's what the SharePoint development is really about in the social part, right? So you can see here that in my news feed, I'm getting updates from people in my community, which at tomreising.sharepoint.com is really only me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's right.
So me posted 9 minutes ago a picture of some chocolates that my mom sent me for my birthday.
Oh, that's very sweet.
Yes. And in my reply to myself, which my mom also taught me was the indicator that you were you're really sick, is she said, it's okay if you hear me talking to myself, but when I start replying, that's when you know.
That's usually when it's time to go home.
Yeah.
My indicator is always, because I talk to inanimate objects, if the inanimate object starts talking back, that's my indication that it's time to head home.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, in this case, for the sake of the demo, I'm going to reply to myself.
Okay.
All right. And I want to show you how a reply works and how at mentions work, which I'm the only person in my community, so I'm going to at mention myself again. Right. So, thanks for the chocolates. I can't spell chocolates. Thanks for the candies.
All right. Yep. Yep.
And I will at mention myself. And you can see there I get the type ahead, the suggestion, and the FYI people I mention will see the post even if they aren't members of this community. And then I can also, you know, hashtag this advanced SharePoint, right? Which clearly, you know, that was pretty advanced.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So Now that I've posted this, I've got you've got a couple of links here in my at mention here. I've got this link back to my site, right?
Yep.
For who mentioned you. So this is about connecting people in your organization. And I've got a hyperlink to show me all the posts tagged with advanced SharePoint, which right now should be about one, right? And you can see here for tags, there are one of the objects that you can follow in SharePoint.
Nice.
You see here on the right-hand side, I'm following one tag at the moment. If I click follow chocolate,
okay,
the user interface changes so that I can stop following chocolate. It's aware I'm already following chocolate, which is a best practice for developers if you are exposing these functionalities in your own code.
Yep.
And you can see here on the right-hand side, it's changed to two tags that I'm following there. So basically, anytime I want to follow anything that's happening in SharePoint, tomreising.sharepoint.com on the subject of chocolate.
Excellent. It's very important.
Well, depends who you are. If you're Hershey's or Cadbury, it could be very important.
There you go.
All right, so that's a little bit of a walkthrough of some custom of some social features in SharePoint Online, specifically tagging and following.
Yep.
And I even mixed in a little bit of at mentioning there.
There you go.
I'll do the slide dance,
yeah,
right, and back into the slides. Okay, so I mentioned again the app permissions. We've seen this in a previous demo on the app manifest. This is something that Visual Studio has a visual interface for. If you want to do a social app, these are the permissions that you want to be aware of. We've got three in specific, right? We've got the user profiles, and the core social, and the microfeed. Now, when you're doing app development, there is a specific permission that you can use during the development that is required if you're not deploying your social app to an app catalog. We've talked previously about app catalogs.
Right, yep.
And so this is kind of a shortcut, and that is specifically the tenant permission right here. So using these permissions, you'll prompt the user when they're installing the app part or the app itself on your site, and they will be asked, do you want to allow access to all of these different things? And then your client-side object model code will run correctly, and you will not get a permission denied in the console window.
And one little thing that's worth highlighting about those permissions there is when you go to install the app, because users can install apps now, and the app is requesting some level of permission, the user is only able to grant a permission that they also have. So if there was something, maybe full access to the tenant or otherwise, that the user didn't have, they're not going to be able to install the application. So this isn't going to be some way to get for a user to get around the permission set that they have, that they're only going to be able to install an app that's going to perform operations that they had the ability to do on their own without the
Awesome. And as we also saw in the previous module on user profiles, search is also a big part of making your apps social. And so, of course, you would want to ask for that permission as well if you're creating a social app using search. I mentioned actors in the overview, and here's a list of the actors that you have available to you to interact with, right, basically. Mm-hmm. So when you're following something, that's an action, you're taking on an actor. There's an SP actor class, social actor class that works with these four types. You've got user, site, tag, and document. So you saw one example of how I did that through the user interface already. I followed a tag, right? So the tag in that case was the actor. If we were doing that programmatically, we'd be using the social actor class, the type of tag, and then we would be using, we could follow that way. And again, you can follow users, sites, tags, and documents.
Yep.
And there's also a note there about how actors act on other actors. So I interacted with a tag. I was the user actor. The tag was the actor that was followed.
Yep, right? That's correct.
Now, specifically, when we're writing code to do the things that I did in the user interface, you're going to be using the social follow manager entity. And you're going to interact with the social actor info. Like I mentioned in the previous, you can follow sites, users, tags, and documents. So how do you know if an actor can be followed?
Or whether or not, if you're executing code, if the user's already following the actor? Because you're going to need to figure that out before you start showing a link as to whether or not somebody can now follow it, or showing that following or stop following. Like you mentioned when you were doing your little demo, you went in, you hit follow, it changed the interface. You want to be able to print out the appropriate text as well.
Absolutely. I didn't print out the code here. I'm sorry. So let me see if I can pull this up. I'm going to do a little slide dance.
Okay. Yep. And, there we go.
And meanwhile, I want to talk about
What I would mention, you know, while you bring that up, is just simply the fact that you do have the ability to find out what the user is actually doing and what the user can do. Because if you are going to create the interface that's going to allow for this social integration, you need to make sure that that you're providing the appropriate options. I mean, I suppose on some level it would be possible to just go ahead and try and follow something, catch the exception, and then go on from there. But whenever we're talking about just doing good code, it's always the best practice to figure out whether or not something is going to work first before you actually attempt it.
All right, great. Let me show you real quick in Visual Studio a little example follow code in the JavaScript object model. All right. I didn't need to wrap that in a function because it was already a function. Okay. So for following, once again, whenever we're in an app and we're interacting with SharePoint, we're going to get the context. We've seen that a few times. We've got our social following manager that we introduced earlier. And, of course, we're going to be storing our actor info. So you can see here that the actor info includes, or the following manager has a property mm-hmm. on it, is followed.
Right. That's very simple. Yep.
So
it doesn't get more straightforward than that. Is followed.
Is followed. Now that's but you want to take advantage of that and
yep.
And basically, you know, you want an if statement on the is followed value
yep.
and you can toggle this, right? So
yep.
Again, for your user interface, you want to show stop following if it's already followed, and similarly if you click on it, you only want to stop if you're following or follow if you're not.
Absolutely. Yep. Very simple.
Very good. So this is also, I've got an example here of how you fill out the, how you get the social actor info here in the new sp.social. And you're sourcing, of course, the sp.social.js.
Right. Yep, exactly. And kind of going back again to the conversation that we were having before, is that if you are going to be utilizing any of these bits of functionality, you almost always need to include the appropriate calls to the libraries now. So it does require a little bit more thinking to actually make that happen. Just have to remember, yeah, that's right, I need that library, I need that library. The other little problem to keep in mind, of course, is that if you're in JavaScript land, it's a brand new country, JavaScript land. If you're in JavaScript land, you need to remember that what you'll wind up getting is a whole bunch of null reference exceptions if you forgot a library. This is where doing something like C# becomes a little bit friendlier, because it will give you a very simple little, hey, by the way, buddy, did you forget a reference to help make your life a little bit easier there? Plus, it wouldn't compile if you missed the reference there.
Absolutely. All right, great. So something that's similar to following, but a little bit different, is liking. And you can follow certain actors, but liking occurs on a post. And again, similarly, if it's already liked, you don't want to like it again.
Exactly, yeah, you don't want to show that link again.
So now, Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was just gonna do the little dance while you brought up Visual Studio over there. All I was gonna say is just simply that with liking, unlike following, so following is a great way for me to kind of see what's going on. Liking is a very easy way for me to provide feedback, and you'll notice that you can do this with all sorts of different posts, and it's just a nice, simple way to say, hey, not only is maybe that very cool, but it's also just potentially a little bit of good information as well to kind of provide feedback what it is that that works well on a news feed.
Yeah, absolutely. And another way that liking helps is you can almost think of it as social bookmarking as well, right?
Yep.
That you can keep track of it. You can see it in your own profile. Other people can see it in your profile. And as of course, the original author of mm-hmm. the post knows as well that you've liked it, right? So if you want to do this in JavaScript, you want to take advantage of the liker info. And I've got an example of that. Yeah. It's
very get liker info.
How about
I love
that,
it.
Right?
Yes.
Why not?
Yep.
And if the liker info includes the current user,
yep.
then you know not to like it.
Yep.
Right? And if it does, then once again, we're doing some very similar things that we've done with previous apps where we are loading our payload is going to be a feed manager this time, and we execute our query async. We've got our success and failure messages there once again that we'd post.
Excellent.
Okay, so that's a little bit on managing social information in SharePoint, and now we'll talk a little bit more about the feeds, also referred to as news feeds.
Excellent.
Activity streams. All right, so let's take a look at some code involving feeds. We've kind of looked at it a little bit mm-hmm. in the browser, and let's dive a little deeper. Feeds are actually not just on the My site. So I showed
yep.
an example of a feed on a My site, but you can actually have a feed on another site.
And this is a big change now in 2013. Now, one of the things that Tom had mentioned earlier about the fact that, you know, people used to use email, and we really should remember that it's used to use email. Twitter, Facebook, yes, obviously, that's become a lot more prevalent. And people who've spent a lot of time using that interface, that's sort of their more natural way of communicating. But also, as Tom mentioned, it's a much more natural way of communicating, of just kind of bouncing ideas back and forth. So if I go in, for example, and I set up a site for a meeting, I want to be able to kind of bounce back and forth real quick ideas. You know, maybe ask a very simple question, hey, what's going to be covered in this meeting? Do I really need to be there? Hey, by the way, we forgot to invite John. Do we want to make sure that we get John in there? And it's a very easy way to go in and ask those types of questions right there on the site's main page, rather than maybe burying that inside of a message board or worse yet, burying that inside of email. Just put that into one nice, neat little location. So having that capability, being able to do that on any site, having that that feed there is rather nice.
Absolutely. And then another use case you can apply the site feed feature to is project management. So say, for example, there's a number of team members participating in a project, and you want to get regular updates on
yep.
what's going on with the project. This is really the heart of moving to a more personal way of using the web.
Yep, absolutely, absolutely.
As I mentioned, that's the feature, the site feed feature. You go to your site settings, site features, turn on the site feed feature, and then you will have the micro feed web part available to you.
Yep.
So there's a few different names it's going by here, news feed, micro feed, site feed, and they're all referring to the same thing.
Basically, we all just want to be fed. See what I did there? A little pun, say feed.
I think you're ready for dinner.
Well, you know, as a matter of fact, in any event, moving on.
So there's note that the as we've already seen, the site feed feature is already activated on everyone's My Site. So as you create a My Site, you will have that available to you. It's not activated by default on most other site templates. In fact, I haven't seen one where it is.
Okay.
So if you want to make that available, you're going to have to go into site settings, you or your site administrator. It's a site feature.
Yep.
All right. So there's also a note that my sites use different content types on their feeds than regular feeds. So it doesn't change how you interact with it, either as a user or a developer.
But just something to be aware of.
And it can affect search.
Yep.
Okay, so once again, similar to how we had the manager for follows, we've got a social feed manager that we can use to interact with it through the code. And similar to the actor info, in this case we have feed options that we can work with. And as you saw in the user interface when I was replying to an existing post,
right,
we're in a threaded interface here. So there's the concept of a parent and children in the posting on the feeds.
Yep. So we go from the feed manager down to the feed itself and then go get all the threads and the different items inside of there. Perfect.
Absolutely. So similarly to retrieving the information from a feed through the threads, you can also post. And the default, of course, that's available to everybody is being able to post to in your code. You can post to the current user's my site, right?
So right.
You're writing code that's going to be deployed, and a user's going to be using it. And they have available to them the ability to post to their own my site through your code.
Right? Excellent. Okay.
And you can also, of course, if you're on one of the other sites, like we were talking about with project management, mm-hmm. you have the option to post then directly to that site's feed. Right. So these are different feeds. We've got one on our my site, and then we've got others on other sites. And you want to be aware of that both through the user interface and through the code. And then the third option you have when programmatically dealing with these feeds is to reply to an existing post in, like the thread. So those are your three targets for posts from code.
Excellent.
Now, when you're working with at mentions and tags, like I did through the user interface, there's a little bit of a parallel to the managed metadata service, going all the way full circle back to module one, managed metadata
all
service.
All the way back to this morning. Seems like such a long time ago now.
Yeah. Remember, Christopher, how easy it was to post the managed metadata tag to
yep.
the new column in the user interface?
Yeah. It took a few lines of code.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, in the user interface, it was easy. In the code, it was complicated. Now,
yep.
At mention and tags are not quite as complicated as posting a managed metadata tag to a column, luckily, but they're a little bit more involved than a normal text post, right?
Right.
So you can see an example here of how you would deal with it, and it's similar to the string format syntax for C# that you'd be familiar with.
Yep.
But this is how you would also apply it in JavaScript. So if in the user interface, I was going to type, hi, at Pat,
mm-hmm.
are you working on hashtag P892?
Right.
In my code, I'm actually going to want to put the curly brackets in with the zero, counting
okay.
starting at zero, and a curly bracket with the one, and then pass in an array of social data item objects, which I will build separately.
Okay. And so that would have both Pat, and then you'd also put in the hashtag
right.
As well. Okay. Fair enough. I gotcha. I'm following.
Good. You're following me.
See what I did there?
Yeah. Are you following me?
I believe I am.
Good.
All right.
All right. So now we've talked about the social data available to us in SharePoint. We've talked about feeds, and now let's look at how we would make an app part.
Sounds perfect.
That deals with people. Right?
Make it so.
All right. Go ahead.
Yep, let's just go ahead and get out. Yeah, we need to do the bring up Visual Studio dance. There you go.
Very good. All right, so in Visual Studio, we have available to us in the interface the ability to add a new app part.
Yep.
So we showed how the default has a default.aspx and an app.js. And when you want to add an app part,
yep,
you can come in here to the new items and select client web part.
Excellent. Okay.
I've gone ahead and done that in this solution I have open. And you can see that I've named the app part.
Social app part. Yeah, that's a creative name. Yep, I'm with you.
And once again, at the top, I've sourced, in this case, search.js, because
okay.
I'm going to expose the user profile data
okay.
through an app part.
Excellent.
And also, you can see, note a couple other things that are different about an app part. We've got this allow framing tag at the top.
Because after all, when you do an app part, it really is just simply an iframe. That's what's going to make the magic happen, make that appear as though it was a traditional web part as opposed to a full-blown page.
And we've got some JavaScript that comes actually as part of the template for the app part that will help with the styles for the, you can see here, the styles from the underscore layouts to apply as well. All right, and I've gone ahead and I've added, this isn't by default, so I added a line here for an appart.js, and I added an additional JS to my project.
Okay.
And I've put some code in there, because I think that's a best practice. I don't want to be writing a lot of JavaScript code inline in my ASPX page.
Yep, I'm with you.
Although I'm still using document.ready.
Yeah, that's all right. I'll forgive you.
We're once again getting the client context, and we can see this familiar people search query that we've already talked about with our lovely GUID in it. And let's take a look at how this works when we deploy it.
Okay.
All right.
And so again, this is going out to your SharePoint Online?
This is going to SharePoint Online, and What's going to be loaded every time you F5 debug on an app part is your app web. Now, in this case, we're specifically building an app part to target at other websites other than the app web.
Right.
So, in this case, I'm going to go to a different site. I'm going to go just to my main dev site.
Okay.
And I've got a social app part page. And just to make sure that I was in edit mode, I want to make sure that I'm not getting any timeout issues there. So I'm going to put it back in edit mode here.
There we go.
And I created a social app part page specifically for the purpose of adding my app part to
there
it.
There you go. Okay.
And you can see my social app part appears in the app parts list. One thing I want to point out here, I think it's always funny to me, is that app parts really are web parts. And they show up in the web part list as well.
Yes, they do.
So this one over here is just a shortcut for the category of web parts that we're calling app parts. So I'm going to put in my social app part, insert it onto the page, and it's working on it. And I'm going to save.
Get right on that, Rose.
And there we go. There is our social app part. It's pulled up my account name. Clearly, I could do the similar things as I did
yep.
in the other search where I pulled up my preferred name and my about me and all kinds of things, feeds and follows and tags and all the great social stuff. And it's available to you now in the client-side object model and in app parts on websites anywhere throughout your SharePoint farm.
Exactly. So that way you could actually do this both on-prem as well as with 0365.
Yeah. Yeah, and it
excellent.
It really applies well. I've got, I've just got a couple references I'll point out for all of this code.
Back onto our slides. There we go.
For all this code, once again, there's a great, from the user perspective, there's a great chapter on this in SharePoint 2013 Inside Out.
Yep.
And on the on the developer perspective, there's a full chapter on these social aspects in Chapter 17 of Inside SharePoint 2013.
Excellent. All right. So what we saw here was how to go back and introduce in the different social aspects, being able to do things like feeds, posts, and following, and also, of course, go in and do liking. And that pretty much, I think, wraps it up not only for the module, but for the day. A couple little housekeeping items before we let everybody go, and including ourselves. Number one is you will notice down at the bottom of the screen, which I actually have up the chat window right down here, which is why I'm going like this. But what you'll notice down below is my is the little poll. Please go ahead, take a second to fill that out. Just go in, click that, let us know how we did.
Number two. Liked us, right?
Oh, yes, if you liked us. You'll also notice, if we get the little highlight down at the very bottom again, I'm still Christopher. That is still Tom. Our Twitter handles, there we go, are our titles, Microsoft Certified Trainer, pre-sales, and everything is a list. There we go. That's really the golden lesson for everything. Awesome. So with that, hope you guys enjoyed it. Hope you guys learned a lot. And I want to thank you guys for your time. Tom?
Christopher, thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
I really enjoyed it. Thanks, everybody, for listening, and I hope you learned a lot.
Yep. We'll see you again. Thanks.